Yeah, just occurred to me that I almost have a 10-year anniversary. Anyway, yes, as I mentioned, I'm a staff member at the European Spallation Source. And if I can change the slide, I can't. There we go. And the title of this presentation here is Science and Data Analysis at the European Spallation Source. I've seen somewhere data reduction also has been mentioned, and that's okay, because I will also mention that briefly. So first, just to put this presentation in context, let me mention two Swedish events. The one is in, or was in 1994 in Stockholm, where the Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded to Schull and Brockhausen for demonstrating that neutrons can be used for probing the atomic structure and dynamics of materials. 20 years later in Lund, construction of the European Spallation Source began, and it has a construction budget, or had a construction budget, of almost 2 billion euros. And this is just to say that society actually thinks that neutron scattering is quite important, otherwise they would not be willing to make that kind of investment. So for this presentation here, I will give a brief introduction to neutrons and neutron scattering, talk a little bit about European Spallation Source, and then reflecting from where I'm from, discuss scientific software for instruments and users. I would also like to discuss open science and fair data, because I believe this will have a huge impact on how science will be performed in the future. And then finally, if you want to learn more about this topic, I will give you some links to other resources. So is that neutrons, as you probably know, something you can find in a nucleus. But it was first discovered in the early 30s by James Chadwick, who actually proved its existence. And I can see now that there's some mess up with my slides, but I hope I will just try to proceed and see if it works. But it was first published in, or he first announced that there was, that the neutron possibly existed in a letter to Nature in 1932. So what is unique about the neutron? It is, first of all, that it is a neutron, hence the name neutron. It is a spin 1.5 particle. It scatters from nuclei, so it's deeply penetrating. One way to think about that is that the distance between two nuclei is in the order of angstroms, whereas the radius of a nucleus is in the order of femtometers. So seen from the perspective of a neutron, there's a lot of empty space in a crystal. Whereas if you are a photon, the space is full of electrons. It's basically just one big electron cloud. So this is deeply penetrating, but it can also scatter from magnetic dipoles if you have unpaired electrons due to the spin of the neutron. And then also, quite importantly, it actually has a non-zero mass, unlike the photon. And to the right is a figure from a famous booklet that you can download from the internet if you want. It's a good starting point for learning about neutron scattering, but it shows the different interactions for neutrons. It can scatter from the nuclei. You can have dipole-dipole interaction if there's an unpaired electron, whereas the X-ray scatter due to electromagnetic interactions, or due to interaction with the electrons, and electrons due to electrostatic interactions. So that's the different types of interactions for X-rays and neutrons, and also electrons in this case here. The question is then, I just want first to mention, I mentioned that it has a non-zero mass. That's important. If you use de Broglie's wavelength equation, this is this one up here, in combination with the classical expression for the momentum, it's fairly easy to show that if you can measure the velocity, you can also determine the wavelengths. And this is actually very useful in practice and for many techniques, Because if you can measure the time of flight from when the neutron was at point A and when it was detected at point B, you can calculate the velocity, and from that you have the wavelengths and the energy. And that is a very important feature for many techniques in neutron scattering. So that's a way to measure the energy of, or the energy loss or gain by a neutron. The neutrons we are interested in have wavelengths in the order of angstroms. And usually we call them thermal neutrons if the wavelength is between 1 and 4 angstrom, and cold if the wavelength is longer than that. And basically because it corresponds to thermal temperatures and low cold temperatures. So that's that. The question is now, how do we get hold of these neutrons? So basically, Chadwick just proved that they existed. Now we want to make use of them. And one way to get neutrons is from fission. So shown here to the left, a neutron hits a target nucleus. It cleaves the nucleus into two other smaller nuclei. And in the process, it also generates 3 neutrons. And each of those neutrons can then hit another target nucleus and then again create 3 other neutrons. And then we have a chain process or a nuclear bomb. But it is possible to control, as we know, the process, so we can have a nuclear reactor. And it is also possible to extract some of those neutrons from the reactor. And this was proposed already during World War II by Wonen and Schull, that worked on the Manhattan Project. And part of that Manhattan Project was the X-10 graphite reactor at Oak Ridge National Laboratory. And his idea was then to be able to or to extract the neutrons from that reactor and use it for studying diffraction from a single crystal. And the letter in the middle is actually to the, I don't know exactly who, a director of some kind, that is asking for permission to use an opening in the pile, as it says. At least this work could be done. And they made a lot of very, very interesting, or got a lot of interesting results. And Schull actually also got, as I mentioned in the beginning, the Nobel Prize in 1994 for this work. Just an example is the Lau diffraction from sodium chloride crystal from 1949. So neutron scattering is really a side project from a good one, I think, from the Manhattan Project. An alternative to fission is spallation. So this is what will be done at European Spallation Source. In that process, protons are accelerated, hence we have this long accelerator, up to very high velocities before they hit a target of a neutron-rich material that will be sitting here in the center, and at ESS is composed of tungsten. And that then knocks out, in very simple words, it knocks out neutrons from the nuclei, and the neutrons are cooled down by a so-called moderator and then guided through these lines out to the instruments. And these, for these long instruments here, these guidelines are approximately 150 meters long. So it's very big instruments. And the sample that you would like to study at ESS would then be placed assembly environments at the end station here, or over here, or down here. So that's the spallation process. And different from the fission, you need to keep it going, you need to add energy in order to keep it going, whereas fission is a chain process that can explode. So there are some safety differences as well between those two. But I guess the real reason for using spallation is that we can get more flux out of that process than we can get from reactors. What you see here is the flux from different sources over time. And actually Chadwick's original experiment is down here, 1 neutron per second per square centimeter. You have the X10 reaction here, and then we have ILL in Chernobyl over here, which I guess is the most powerful, or at least close to being the most powerful reactor in the world, research reactor in the world. But the flux is basically saturated. It's impossible to get more flux out from reactors. And therefore, people have started to look at the spallation process, and you can see that now it is possible to get more flux out from spallation. JPARC in Japan and SNS in the US are both fairly new sources, and the European Spallation Source will then be on this plot, will be somewhere out here. So that's the reason for moving to spallation and use the spallation process. This is actually quite interesting, I find, part of, if you put this in a global context, I mentioned SNS in the US and Japan, or JPARC in Japan, that they both have spallation sources, and we are now constructing ESS in Europe. Just like spallation sources, there is actually a high flux reactor neutron source in each of those major economic areas. It's high-level in Grenoble in Europe. There's also a free electron laser in each of those. And its European X-field has started recently in Hamburg. And we have the high intensity X-ray synchrotron, which is ESIF in Grenoble. So each of these areas actually have one each of those tools in their toolboxes for material science. So what else is different between neutron and X-rays? One big difference in particular for life sciences and also hydrogen energy and batteries is that neutrons can see light elements. X-ray, on the other hand, they see electrons, and hydrogen atom only have one electron, so it's very hard for X-ray to see a hydrogen atom or deuterium atom because they still only have one electron. Whereas if you go up in weight or in atomic number, the number of electrons increases and it becomes a lot easier to see the element for X-rays. For neutron, hydrogen turns out to have the bigger cross-sections of all the isotopes because neutrons, the scattering for, is isotope dependent for neutrons because it's scattered from the nuclei. So the scattering cross-section is actually different for hydrogen and deuterium. But you can see the light elements with neutrons, and that is shown here to the right with these old-fashioned analog cameras. In the top, you see a picture radiograph, just like the one you get at a hospital with X-rays. Just using neutrons here, and you can see that the metal casing is basically transparent, whereas you can see the organic material, you can see the film inside it. For X-rays, it's quite the opposite. You can see the metal casing, but you cannot see the film at all. So this is how the two techniques complement each other. There's also this famous movie on YouTube where you can see an espresso maker in work. You can find it on YouTube if you want to see it all, but it's basically the espresso maker is transparent, it's aluminum, whereas you can see the water inside it. So let's stop that. Okay, so neutrons versus X-rays. They complement each other. So neutrons see light elements, particularly hydrogen, but also lithium, which is important for batteries. To see unpaired electrons, so magnetic materials, they're deeply penetrating, isotope dependent, and that can be used for something called contract matching. I will not discuss that here, I'm just mentioning that you can, by adding heavy water to an aqueous solvent, you can actually make a component of a solution invisible. This is a quite useful technique in life science. It's also non-destructive. It doesn't destroy the sample that is being studied. There are also some not so good things, otherwise it would have been more widely used, I think. It's very low flux compared to X-rays. It means bigger samples and longer exposure time. I think, for instance, for protein crystallography, lithography, you need a week's exposure time at ESS. So that's quite different from synchrotron. It's expensive and there are very few sources available. So that's the difference between using X-rays and neutrons. European spallation source next to MAX4. We have the bridge and we have, you can't see it here, but something called the Data Management and Software Center over here in Copenhagen. I'll come back to that. But ESS, this is a rendering of how it's envisioned to look like once it's fully constructed. This will be pretty soon. Right now it looks like something like in the photography here to the right, that's from April, and you can see the buildings are popping up. And actually the first staff members have moved to one site and have done now the daily work there. In 2014, when we started, there was a complete empty field, so-called greenfield, and nothing was there. On this picture, you can actually start to see the contours of the accelerator and the target building and experiment halls here. And all of this is going on in Lund, of course. ESS is a spallation source, but it is quite different from other spallation sources in operation. It's a so-called long pulse source. And it means that the proton beam hits the target 14 times per second, and for each time a pulse of neutrons is generated. And at ESS, that's a long pulse, whereas at other sources, it's a very narrow pulse compared to ESS. And what it means is that the time resolution, I mentioned time of flight before, is not as good as at other sources, unless you make the beam lines very long. Over the longer distance you measure time of flight, the more accurate it gets compared to the length of the pulse. Or you can also chop up the pulse using choppers, especially rotating wheels that chop the beam off. And in that way, you can generate a series of very narrow pulses. So you can basically shape and design the pulse as you want to. And that comes with a number of advantages for instrument techniques. And of course, the long pulse also means you have a lot of flux and intensity compared to the other sources. The toolbox at ESS is, we have 15 instruments planned. There's Odin for imaging, for diffraction. We have an instrument for engineering diffraction, one for powder diffraction, or two for powder diffraction, one for single crystal, and one for macromolecular crystallography. For large scale structures, we have two instruments planned for sands, small angle neutron scattering, and two planned for reflectometry. And for spectroscopy, we have one planned for molecular spectroscopy. That means that the vibrations for quens, quasi-elastic neutron scattering, that's for instance diffusion or rotation of missile groups that we can detect with that. And inelastic neutron scattering, that's phonons and spin excitation, spin waves, etc. You can probe with that technique. So there's a wide range of different instruments designed to study very different materials and phenomena. And just to show the scale again, this is a rendering of the instrument Odin. That's an imaging instrument, it's located here. And hard to see, but there's actually a person standing there, and that sort of like gives you the size of this instrument here. It's big instruments compared to X-rays facilities. A lot of concrete. What it means is, just like for synchrotrons, there's a wide range of time and length scales that can be studied with spectrum scattering. Everything from physics, angstroms and picoseconds, down to engineering and material science. And I'll just give a few examples. Imaging, there's computer tomography, standard technique, I believe, in X-ray. But where you take radiographs from different angles and you can combine it into a 3D volume. And also on the slide here, I have an image of a fuel cell, but you can see how water is distributed. Again, because you can see the light or you can see hydrogen. But going back to the computer tomography, that can be used to study how a cannonball is constructed. This is from a battle, I don't remember the year, but it's from a battle in England many years ago. And this is a study by under Kastner at Porsche Institute in Switzerland. And the green color is lead. And you can see some rust because inside it, there is a core of iron. That's actually asymmetric, so I guess this cannonball would tumble in the air and probably is a lot more dangerous in that way. So this is just one example in one extreme end of how you can use neutrons. Another example is actually a bit related to this. There's another macroscopic object. This is a railway rail. And for each of the dots here, a diffraction measurement or experiment has been done. And from that, you can calculate the lattice constant for each point. So what you can see is that in this railway rail, there's a lot of residual stress, particularly the red color part here. I guess the lattice constant is shorter than usual. So that's another example in the macroscopic world, or link of macroscopy to macroscopic elements. Single crystal diffraction. You can study or you can obtain both the crystal structure of the crystal, but you can also obtain the magnetic structure, again, of this crystal using neutrons. And you again mention, you can see the hydrogens in proteins. And that's, of course, very important because proteins are a crucial part of the function of enzymes. So that's a very important study, and there are a lot of expectations to the instrument NMX. And finally, spin waves in yttrium iron oxide can be studied, for instance, at an instrument like Bifrost at ESS in the future. And I should say, I have nothing to do with these examples here, except that I have found them and now using them for this presentation here. But it's just a short, the wide range of studies that can be done at ESS. So scientific software for instruments and users. Again, at ESS, we have the Data Management and Software Center, and that is actually not located in Lund, but in Copenhagen. And this is where I have my daily work outside Corona times. So we are located in this COBIS building, which is on the campus in Copenhagen, and you might have seen the building before if you collaborate with somebody at University of Copenhagen. But our task at the DMSC is simply to provide all the scientific computing or scientific software that the users need and the instrument teams need in order to perform the experiments and analyze the data afterwards. The way we look at it is through this data pipeline. You control your experiment and you acquire some data. You can stream neutrons, its events. You can basically detect each time a neutron hits the detector. And we also stream meter data like temperature, pressure, whatever. We reduce the data, meaning we convert the raw data to intensity, basically as a function of the scattering vector and energy gain or loss. We analyze those data, and that's technique dependent. And of course, we also And I say, of course, that's not always the case. The synchrotrons are known, but we store the data so we later can retrieve them, and we use the LINXS format for that. Also in the scope of the data management of software center is to provisioning all the hardware required to run this data pipeline. And we are also responsible for provisioning the user office software. This is the software used to communicate between the users and the facility, similar to synchrotrons. So that's the data pipeline. Just to show an example, so down here we have the detectors, we have the raw data that is not animated, I should say, but you can see where you have a high intensity on the detector. You take those raw data and you convert them to basically histogram. So intensity as function of the scattering vector. This is a SANS experiment, by the way. So we just have the scattering vector here. And then you have a hypothesis. In this case, the scattering is from a sphere. And we actually know how the scattering pattern from a sphere look like and how it depends on the radius of the sphere. So we can fit the model to the acquired data or the reduced data. And this is being updated as data coming in. And you can see here, this is the radius, and you can see that it converts towards a value which is slightly higher than 25 angstrom. And also here, the background is also fitted in this process. And this is actually a typical workflow for analysis. It will be demonstrated at the two next webinars. For diffraction, 2 weeks time for now, and SANS in 1 week from now. But basically acquire data, define a model with some free parameters, and calculate the scattering pattern for that model, and fit the free parameters to the experimental data. It's a typical workflow, but it's not the only one. There are also model-free analysis that can be done. So, another thing which can be done, this is just to go a little bit outside the textbook examples, is that we can take an existing model for water, a force field used for MD simulations. And for those of you who have done MD simulations of water, you know that there are many, many different models, OPC, SPCE, T3P, etc., etc. And we can then do MD simulations for each of those models, and we can calculate how the quasi-elastic Newton scattering spectrum will look like. So this is from an MD simulation, and this is the real data, and these are actually from Bertha Haller at Lund University. So this research is actually an example of how data can be reused for other purposes. And we can see, so I guess this is T3P, that there's quite a big difference here. And again, what we can show is that T3P is actually an outlier and does not reproduce the dynamics very well. And it becomes worse as we reduce the temperature actually down to supercooled water. So this is just another example of how LINXS can be used just for evaluating existing models. This research is, by the way, funded by this research council, and it's in collaboration with ISIS, where Thomas Farmer is, Anders Magnussen there, and Heloisa Bordala at University of Copenhagen, and Jens Svensson at Chalmers is the PI. And I'm also involved in this project myself. Anyway, we need to support all techniques for data analysis, and that's a huge task because there are really many different techniques and there are really many different scientific areas, and they all would like to have different software. We cannot do that ourselves. We simply don't have the resources for doing that or expertise. So we collaborate with basically all neutron sources, at least the major ones in Europe and also SNS in the US on that. So next week, there will be a presentation about SASView for SANS. That is something we do in collaboration with ISIS in the UK and ILL in France, as well as SNS in the US and NIST and other facilities. That's really a big international collaboration. You also, in 2 weeks from now, hear about easy diffraction, full prof CRISPR for diffraction. And that is in collaboration with LLB, ILL, France. So we do collaborate with basically the entire world about techniques. We also collaborate with universities about developing new methods for analysis. I should say part of this work has been funded by an EU project called Science 2020. It's now ended. Good. Another. So the one challenge is, of course, the diversity of the science and the techniques. Another challenge is the community, which is very diverse. Maybe the most scientific software is Excel that they're used, and for other people like to script an entire experiment using Python or MATLAB, for instance. And we need to support both types of users, and sort of like the typical way of doing that, or at least the way we do that, is to provide both a graphical user interface and scripting interfaces. We do have, in order, partly for our own sake, because we operate with a lot of different software, and we would like that to look as much as each other as possible, so it's easier to move from one to another software. But we would also like to make it easier to collaborate with other facilities, and in particular, that, for instance, scientists at universities also can contribute to data analysis software. So therefore, we have a set of standards or guidelines also developed in the project Science 2020. And basically, it recommends to use C++ if you need something high-performance language, but otherwise Python, particularly for scripting. If you want to use make a GUI, use Qt, but try to avoid it, would be my recommendation. And I can also say that all the software we work with is on GitHub and open source. What I would like to stress, though, is that it's extremely important to do testing, make it a habit to write test, and also version control. And it's simply a matter of developing maintainable and sustainable software, also for your own sake. For those of you who might want to develop software for research, or maybe even contribute to existing projects, I would recommend to participate in a workshop on how to develop research software in a sustainable way. And there are different places where you can do that, but one is the Code Refinery that actually organizes workshops at universities all over in all the Nordic countries. So that's just a recommendation from my side, because I think software becomes more and more important, and I think most scientists these days sooner or later gets involved in software development at some level. Yes, it is becoming increasingly important. Just an example from looking at cars, 1977 actually has software in it, 50,000 lines of code. But in 2015, she evolved, that has 10 million lines of code. And then how you will find a different number that says 100 million lines of code for a modern high-end car. Summa summarum, the demand for software is increasing. That also is the case at neutron facilities. Mantid, this is one of the two software we use for data reduction at ESS, has 2.5 million lines of code, and the cost so far has been more than 25 million euros. So it's not cheap either. Also, another thing to pay attention to is that the more lines of code you have, of course, the more functionality, hopefully, the more science you can do. But it also comes with more complexity and therefore an increasing risk of failures. So be concerned about whether the software you're using and the data you publish actually are reproducible. It's another thing that is coming up these days, being discussed. We say at ESS, we will have instrument data scientists that will assist users with data processing. And during a construction phase, they will also facilitate that we at DMSC, and they are hired at DMSC, we actually deliver the right software to the instrument teams. So open science and fair data, still have a bit of time. This is being strongly pushed by the European Commission. And basically, all large-scale facilities in Europe, I think, at least the international ones, like ESS, have committed to open science and the European Open Science Cloud. And one important component of that is the so-called fair data and associated analysis services. Fair data means that data are findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. And what does that mean? It means that, for instance, at ESS, you go and do an experiment, then after 3 years, other people will be able to use those data. That again means two things. You need to document to provide a sufficiently high level of metadata so other users actually can, not only access the data, but actually also can understand them. At least if you want to, them to understand. But you also need to make sure that your data are citable, so that they have digital object identifier. So that's really important. And actually, before I gave an example of how open data can be used, I should be honest and say in this case, we just emailed Helen and got the data, but it is an example of how data can be reused for other purposes. We currently, ESS is member of a project called PANOSC, together with the other so-called S3 on the European Strategy Forum for Research Infrastructures, so the international facilities in Europe, so EXFEL, ESRF, ELI, European Laser Infrastructure, IVEL, and CERI ERIC, which is an umbrella organization for smaller research infrastructures. We are implementing fair data policies, and we are also implementing techniques that, if not exactly sure, at least facilitates that, for instance, analysis can be reproduced. And one of the techniques here is to use Jupyter notebooks that I think many of you probably know, because Jupyter notebooks can be stored as an ordinary data set. So that's that. We just say that it's not only the international facilities that is implementing open science and fair data. We have a sister project called EXPANS, where national facilities are members, and that includes VAX4. So VAX4, we collaborate closely with all these facilities. So this is really a European-wide process of implementing open science and fair data. Data management, since this is a LINXS seminar, I think it would be important to mention that we develop a metadata catalog jointly with MAX4 and also Paul Institute in Switzerland. It's called SciCat, and so that would be a place where you can search on metadata to find specific data sets that you are interested in. Good. Just a bit about, if you're interested in learning more about neutron scattering or what can be done. I mentioned the neutron scattering primer by Roger Pin. You can download it from the internet. It's a very good introduction. But I would also like to mention panlearning.org/eneutrons.org. So panlearning stands for photon and neutron learning. This is an e-learning platform, originally. It was the eneutrons.org because it focused entirely on neutron scattering. But as part of this PANOSC project, we are now expanding it to also include teaching material for photon scattering or for X-ray sources. And for instance, you can find an introductory course to neutron scattering in there. It has quizzes, textbook materials, slides, videos, and you can also, and as part of teaching materials, you're supposed to do simulations of, you know, virtual instruments. So that is actually very good. And I think we are interested in the project in collaborators if somebody wants to help us putting context into this platform. And that's both for the photon side and for the neutron side. Also like to mention that if you need some specific software and you don't know what to use, there's something called the PAN Data Software Catalog, also now maintained by the PANOS project. So this is a place where you can search for software for doing SANS, for instance. And it relies on people registering software themselves. So it's not fully comprehensive, but I think it's actually fairly close to be it. Finally, the next upcoming webinars, one by Wojciech, my colleague, and my other colleague, Andrew Sasanov. So the next one will be on small angle scattering data analysis with SASView. And I guess that also will include SACs, meaning X-rays. And also easy data fraction, that will be 2 weeks from now by Andrew Sasanov. And that is a piece of software which has been developed entirely so far at DMSC and links to other software like FullProf. I think by that, just in conclusion, or as you mentioned, there are also several summer schools on this topic, including Sweden's, of course. So yeah, neutron complements X-rays. They don't replace them, but they complement X-rays. They're sensitive to light elements, magnetism, and they're deeply penetrating. Also like to, modern scientists need software, and it's really good if they contribute, but be careful with sustainability and reliability. Fair data and open science is becoming a reality. And finally, you're welcome to contact us if you would like to contribute to analysis software. And then of course, I should also mention very importantly that the European Spallation Source is becoming a reality as well. I think that was all I would like to say. So yeah, thank you for listening. So if there are any questions.
Thank you very much, Thomas. It was a really great talk. Good. We collected some questions.
Yeah.
I'm gonna read them to you. So the first question is it possible to monitor organic reaction or bond breaking using neutrons?
Indirectly, yes. I mean, catalysis is studied a lot with, to my knowledge, with molecular spectroscopy. So basically, it's the change of vibrations in what you are looking at. So Tosca at ISIS is an example of that. So yes, indirectly, I would say.
Okay.
I mean, it is used for that. So.
Okay, we continue with the next question then. Can we do time-resolved experiments to study photo-triggered reactions or to detect the transition states in the reactions?
Pass. I don't know. but you can study time-resolved reactions. I don't know. I mean, for instance, next week, I'm sure that Wojciech will talk about time-resolved SANS and SACs. But I mean, there is a limit to how much you can do due to the limited flux, I would think. Of but course. I don't know the precise answer to that. I could find out.
So as I said, the audience has different backgrounds, so the question can vary a lot. So some of them can be specific, others a little bit less. So we have another question is, so you talked about photons in your presentation. What's the minimum sample volume and concentration?
What is the meaning of sample volume and...
and concentration for your neutron experiments?
In terms of how well it scatter?
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah. Well, I would think that the higher density of nuclei you have, the more scattering you have, and the bigger volume, the more scattering you have.
Uh-huh.
You need a fairly, I mean, compared to X-rays, you need a fairly big volume. So the beam size, we typically we talk about centimeters. As a synchrotron, we talk about millimeters, right? Or even below millimeters. But yes, it has an impact for how much scattering you get out, of course.
Mm-hmm. So another question is, can we study the interfaces of hybrid devices using neutrons?
Yeah, yes, you can. I guess it's layered structures.
Mm-hmm.
So we have reflectometry for that. Mm-hmm. So that can be studied, yes. I know solar cells is one example of being studied with neutrons.
Okay, the more we talk, the more questions we get. So we're going to use you. So typically, how long does it take to acquire data at the neutron beam line?
Anything from it depends on the technique. So for instance, for mm-hmm. powder and sands, we have high flux. And it also depends on the facility, how much flux do you have. I mentioned NMX, talk about weeks. I mean, that's not the normal case, but I would say anything from hours to a week.
So it really varies between the different facilities.
Yeah, I mean, it depends on how much flux you have, of course.
Mm-hmm.
So ESS would be more powerful. Means that you can do better time resolve experiments, which was mentioned, right? But you also need shorter exposure time, surely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in fact, there is another question here. We learned that X-rays can damage the samples. So is it the same case with neutrons?
No, it's not. Neutrons does not destroy the sample. That's one of the advantages, yes, of neutrons.
Great. So,
I mean, unless there are some elements that becomes, I don't even think that destroys, but there can be elements in that becomes radioactive, like cadmium, stuff like that. But yeah, but usually, no, it does not get destroyed.
Okay. Another question is the data reduction performed on site by the users?
I'm grateful for that question. actually, I did not mention that at all. Both data reduction and data analysis is performed on site, meaning the computers are on site. You don't have to take the data with you. You can do it, but you can log in from home and do data reduction and data analysis. You can also do it on-site, of course, during experiment time or beam time, if you want to. And as I mentioned, we also have an instrument data scientist who can assist, particularly if it is very complicated analysis, of course.
So this will be at ESS, or this is valid for all facilities?
Oh, this is for ESS, but it is actually also the plan in panels for all those facilities that are members. Mm-hmm. And it is up running at ISIS in UK. They have the so-called IDAS system. And also at SNS, they have some remote analysis. So you can log in remotely and do your analysis there on site. Well, you don't have to be on site, but you don't have to take the data out in order to analyze them. And that's simply because the data sizes are becoming bigger and bigger, and at some point, becomes impossible to move the data out, or at least not feasible. So that's for neutron sources. I mean, the problem is even worse or much, much bigger for synchrotrons because they produce a lot more data.
Okay. We have another question. This is a little bit more specific. Is it possible to quantify the hydrogen segregated at the grain boundaries in metallic alloys? If yes, what's the lowest detectable limit one can achieve?
Yeah, that's too specific for me.